Hello, I'm Christopher Wilson, Director of Experience Design at the National Museum of American History at the Smithsonian Institution, and welcome to a History Film Forum discussion of the new film, The Courier, starring Benedict Cumberbatch and Rachel Brosnahan. This program is presented with Smithsonian Associates, Smithsonian's National Museum of American History, and with the participation of Lionsgate Roadside Attractions, and also with the support of Dan Manette and Democracy Films. I'm speaking to you today from Tacoma Park, Maryland, just outside our nation's capital of Washington, DC. And I'm joined by the director of The Courier, Dominic Cooke, who's joining us from London, the film's screenwriter, Tom O'Connor, coming to us from Los Angeles, and my colleague, Claire Jerry, joining us from Washington, DC. Claire is curator in the Division of Political and Military History at the National Museum of American History. At the History Film Forum, we explore film as public history, noting that so many of us learn history through motion pictures, documentary films, television, and more online video. In these programs, we examine the issues surrounding how we present, teach, interpret, and learn history when it is presented on the screen. This film is a great example of an opportunity to learn a new story that adds to and complicates our understanding of the Cold War in the United Kingdom, the Soviet Union, the United States, and indeed around the world. And it was a story that I didn't know before watching the film, so I'd like to start right there. Dominic, welcome and congratulations on this film. And can you tell us a bit more about the story and the main character? Who was Greville Wynne?
Well, Greville Wynne was a salesman. He was actually trained as an engineer, but he was selling, he was a traveling salesman, really, selling sort of manufacturing equipment for factories. And he was, most of his business was in the Eastern Bloc. He wasn't actually traveling to the Soviet Union until he was sort of collared by the CIA and MI6, but he had business over there. I mean, he's a very interesting character for all sorts of reasons, which we can go into, but essentially what happened was that the CIA were contacted by a guy called Oleg Penkovsky, who was quite a senior military intelligence figure. And he was a war hero. He'd been decorated 13 times. He was sort of the real deal. He was sort of defending Kiev from the Nazis, and it's kind of extraordinary, sort of had an extraordinary military record. But his background was as a white Russian. So he was sort of, his dad had been killed by the Soviets during the Civil War. And he was actually sort of working, he was sort of stationed outside the Soviet Union, and he had a sort of really kind of promising career within the hierarchy of the sort of international wing of the Soviet Union. And then they discovered, I think in about 1960, correct me if I'm wrong, Tom, I think it was about 1960, they discovered that his dad had been killed by the white Russians, and he was sort of, his card was marked from that point. So there was a sort of lot of reasons why he was deeply opposed to the Soviet regime. And he sort of, I think he also was genuinely concerned about what he was getting wind of in terms of Khrushchev, who the West had sort of welcomed as, well, I suppose they welcome anything after Stalin, right? So, and they sort of welcomed him because he was reaching out more to the West, and he appeared to be more sort of accommodating and progressive, but he was incredibly reckless and not quite what he seemed. So he was genuinely concerned about that, but he has some pretty deep motivations for detesting the Soviet regime. And I think politically he was pretty conservative, and he'd made a decision that he was going to, sell secrets to the West. And because of his very senior position, I mean, he was, as far as I understand, he was the most senior Soviet spy during the whole of the Cold War. The West was very excited about this. But they'd had some disasters. They'd had some recent disasters in terms of, Western spies being caught. And they decided they wanted a civilian. And so they chose Greville Wynne because he was someone who had a very legitimate cover. He was going to that part of the world. And they thought it would look perfectly reasonable for him to go to the Soviet Union. But despite his claims, because he sort of rewrote his own history, he didn't actually have any sort of espionage history. and initially started off as a as a courier, hence the title, and eventually was involved in bringing back some really important information which affected the outcome of the Cuban Missile Crisis. So he's a sort of everyday guy who became a really important player in that period of history.
And I want to get into more of that later, but I also, one of the many rabbit holes that the film sent me down in Googling, immediately after it, was about what happened afterwards, both to him, and also, can you talk a little bit about what happened to Penkovsky's family after his arrest and death?
There's about five films here. There really are, because it's so interesting sort of how the story was spun. And the sort of risks that both sides were covering up afterwards. So after Wynne was released from prison, I don't think it's a spoiler, but we're speaking to people who've seen the film, but it was sort of widely known that he was, arrested and had the most dreadful experience in prison. And Penkovsky was killed, executed. Well, Wynne was, post-traumatic stress disorder was a term that was only coined in the 80s, but he was clearly suffering from it, and who wouldn't, because he really had endured appalling sort of torture, really, and had managed, all the evidence points the fact that he didn't give anything away, and it was partly because there was this sort of intense friendship between these two men, like an extraordinary sort of admiration, and almost like a sort of platonic romance. They became very, very close, and it was intensified, I think, by the fact that no one knew what they were doing apart from their managers. There was no one, their families didn't know, and so this sort of bond became very, very intense. And I think he really wanted to make sure that he was doing the right thing by Penkovsky. He was also politically quite conservative, and he sort of loathed the Soviets. So he had sort of held out. And been starved, been constantly moved around. He was massively underweight when he came out, and he was clearly very traumatized. And there was no sort of program to help him. They didn't do that stuff. In fact, they just wanted him to go back to civilian life and sort of not be a nuisance. But what happened was, and this I think is a really fascinating story in itself, which we didn't have time to go into, was that he lost a lot of his business, because of course no one in the Soviet Union or in the Eastern Bloc was going to have him going back there. And that was where he made his money. So his income took a big hit, and consequently he sort of used his celebrity status as a means of making money. And he wrote some highly fictionalized books where he sort of completely rewrote his own history and added in a whole sort of espionage history, and in order to make them more saleable, and sort of went on TV chat shows. And MI6, who had agreed to give him a pension, which was something, they were looking after him, basically said in the end, if you don't stop this, we're just gonna cut your pension off. So he was sort of silenced in a way, because he was a bit of a liability. And I think that's one of the reasons why the story sort of faded out of public view. And certainly my parents' generation, who were around at that time, anyone I know of a certain age in the UK knows who Greville Wynne is. When I said I was doing a film about Greville Wynne, anyone sort of over the age of about 65, 70 sort of knows who he is. And anyone under that age has no clue, which is unusual, right? It's kind of unusual that you just know nothing. And Penkovsky is also quite an interesting case, because most of the time when spies were caught, the families were sort of disappeared. I don't think they were killed, they were sort of sent off to sort of the far reaches of Siberia or whatever. In this instance, because he was very well connected, and his wife, her father was extremely sort of a prominent, I think, military guy, was actually sort of allowed to stay in Moscow. And in fact, his daughter ended up working for the KGB. So it's a very unusual situation. She changed, basically his wife renounced her relationship with him, sort of changed her name back, got divorced, and sort of dropped him. But it's really unusual that happened. So, I just find the whole sort of, and then there's a whole propaganda element to what happened, because the Soviets were so embarrassed that such a prominent figure could have leaked what ended up being about 5,000, extremely sensitive documents to the West. So they made him into a really rather grotesque way, actually. They made him into a public enemy and lied about him, said that he didn't have a military, he'd been in an office during the war, and consequently, we need to move on to other things. But when I went to cast the movie in Moscow, quite a few people gave me and the casting director a really hard time, because it's never been revised. you know, the story of him, which was put out by the Soviets, and there were several TV documentaries that were like repeated endlessly. So again, people of a certain generation, they all knew him and they hated him, and they still, a lot of people see him as a traitor, whereas he saw himself as loyal to Mother Russia and a traitor to the Soviet system. He would have, I mean, I think he would have admitted that he hated the Soviet system. He saw the Soviet system as a betrayal of Russia. So it's interesting how in Russia, the sort of version of Penkovsky that the Soviets sort of put out there has remained very sort of accepted by a large number of people.
That's fascinating. And I want to get into some of those issues of characterization and crafting the film and bring Tom in. But first, let's just go move back a little bit into the history. And I wonder if, Claire, you could just shape the moment that this was happening. You study political rhetoric and the Kennedy and presidential administrations. I wonder if you could talk a little bit from the perspective of the Kennedy administration and the dealings with the Soviet Union at this moment, and kind of just set up this moment for us.
Oh, thank you, Chris. I'm just really excited to be here with all of you this evening. You know, this is one of those historical stories that we could start the context like a week before the film starts, or we could go back to the Spanish-American War involved in Cuba. So I'll cut the difference between those and look at sort of the Cold War context, say from the late Eisenhower administration in the late 50s up through the Kennedy administration. And it seems to me there are two important threads of the context. And one is the geopolitical, obviously. And we're in the midst of the Cold War. And I think for many Americans who were not involved in policymaking, the communist threat narrative was very Soviet Union centric. And it was easy to think about the Soviet Union, yes, the threat of nukes, but they're sort of over there. But what the Cuban Missile Crisis makes so clear, and this film does as well, is there was another narrative, which was the Cuba-centric narrative. And what we see in the Kennedy administration are these two narratives, which have been coming closer and closer together, really coming to a head in the Cuban Missile Crisis. And at now it's 90 miles off our coast. And so not only are policymakers bringing these two threads together, American people are now aware of them because we're encountering that. So that's an important context. And then, as Chris said, my background is rhetoric. And so I think it's important to see the Cuban Missile Crisis within the context of a rhetorical narrative. The film sets up, and it's not just American rhetoric. We see Khrushchev clips in this film. We see a number of important Kennedy speeches, and Kennedy lives today even in American imagination as this great rhetorical president. But he starts in his inaugural address with, you know, fighting the foe and defending liberty. And we see him here at the Cuban Missile Crisis in the middle, pulling us back from that threat. And then by the end of his administration, he'll be delivering eloquent speeches about peace and nuclear testing limits. So it's important to recognize that this event does not happen in a political vacuum, but it also doesn't happen in a rhetorical vacuum. And I think the film does a nice job of setting that up.
And can you describe the change in the Kennedy administration with respect to information gathering and planning related to this, that between the early part of the administration with the Bay of Pigs, and by the time we get into this, and how they see the need for espionage and this need for information in order to make their decisions?
The Bay of Pigs is such an important part of the Cuban Missile Crisis story. That was a planned invasion of Cuba that had started in the Eisenhower administration. Kennedy inherits it, and it happens in April. He's only been in office a few weeks. And what happened was his administration sort of bought into it, and it became, we now refer to it as like the initial groupthink story that everybody studies. He got together with his policymakers, they looked at one solution, they moved forward. It was an incredible disaster in all kinds of ways. But what's interesting for the Cuban Missile Crisis is that it shaped not just his external communication, but the way Kennedy processed information internally. His policymakers and he now looked at alternatives. What are the consequences of this action or that action? And you can see, comparing his public rhetoric as well, how he truly changed from that sort of very, really aggressive Cold Warrior to let's look at alternatives. And of course, the Cuban Missile Crisis is a much more successful alternative. And then I think sets up some of those post-Cuban Missile Crisis things we see in the administration as well.
So Tom, you know, it seems to me that you had a big challenge here, you know, because, you know, you're presenting the story and despite Wynne's remaking of his history, you know, afterwards and the Soviet remaking of the history of both Penkovsky and Wynne, you know, you have a story, at least from the Wynne point of view, of not exactly an unwitting spy, but certainly not James Bond. So, what was in your, you know, filmmaking process and your character building process, you know, to create this character on screen in a way that both reflects history and the story that happened and the actual person, but then also will draw people in?
Well, that was a fascinating part of it that Dominic and I worked through a lot, which was all the different conflicting versions of what had happened and sort of teasing out the motivations of different entities and why they portrayed the events the way they did and why Wynne portrayed himself the way they did, why the Soviets did, the Americans did. I think what we really gravitated to, I think very strongly, was a sense of he was just a salesman. And he was, what I think it made it interesting on a writing level, and I think Dominic can speak to this as well, was Wynne was much more like you or me or anyone else that we know, as opposed to someone who's an intelligence operative. And sort of that question we get when he's asked by CIA and MI6, would you do this for us, this incredibly dangerous event, activity, how would I react? You know, how would you react? And I think that was sort of, for me as a writer, that was sort of an entry point into it, was this very human experience of how would I behave in the situation? And that was a very interesting thing to explore with Wynne. It's like, okay, well, here's this man, he's never aspired to have any sort of special, meaningful, memorable life. He was happy making money and selling industrial machinery, and suddenly is thrust into history. And going on that journey with him was really a fascinating experience in the writing.
I want to ask really all three of you a question related to that every man's sense of every person's sense of the story, which I think was really strong. Claire will agree that living and working in D.C. and as government, you know, employees and historians, like, we're often asked to go do talks for other parts of the government. And I remember once going and talking with really a group of spies at an agency in DC. And one of the things that I remember most vividly from that was parking in the parking lot, parking my minivan next to another minivan. We both had the same, you know, youth soccer sticker on the back. And, you know, this place was just filled with normal people doing these, you know, very difficult and demanding jobs. You know, this is a job that wins, you know, takes danger, you know, more danger than the average person has to encounter even in espionage, you know, into account. But what does this story say about how ordinary people play a role in history? Really a question for all of you.
Well, I guess it was, I mean, one of the appealing, I mean, obviously, you know, I mean, the thing that's so interesting about this sort of this question, what this sort of points into is this whole area of, you know, how one in the end plays quite fast and loose with history when one's making a 2-hour film, because you've got to sort of make an editorial decision. You've got to sort of decide what your version of the story is. And one of the things I love, and although we did do work together on the script, I have to say that it wasn't the script I read, which I think was a very early draft, didn't go on a massive journey. The sort of essence of you know, the heart of what Tom wrote was the film we made. And one of the things I loved about it was that it sort of brought a very human situation into the sort of calculating world of espionage and, you know, and the history of those narratives. You know, if you think about John le Carré, they're quite cold. You know, they focus on the sort of calculation and the sort of minutiae of sort of manipulation and you know, so on. Whereas what I sort of loved about this was that it sort of did delve into the personal cost of that, because this guy wasn't prepared, and that was why they wanted him, you know. And it sort of allows, I think, a sort of access into the world that that is very particular, because he's a sort of innocent. And, you know, this idea about change and sort of individuals being able to make change is central to it, is central to the movie, and the sort of the sense that many of us don't know what we're capable of I mean, in a good sense, you know, we don't know the potential we have to do extraordinary things until we're put into that situation. Unfortunately, a lot of us aren't put into sort of dangerous situations where we have to sort of, you know, you hear the stories about the, you know, the mother lifting the car, you know, when the child's in danger, that kind of thing, you know. Fortunately, a lot of us aren't exposed to those things, but I think that idea is sort of a powerful, is a powerful one. But it, I mean, he was, I mean, I found the Greville Wynne books are really interesting, but they're very deceptive because they are sort of boys' own fiction. But there's certain elements of them that really ring true. And one of them is this sort of extraordinary admiration that he had for Penkovsky. And that sort of, the story of loyalty and friendship is actually also incredibly important in this film. So those things are sort of put into the front and sort of intensified by the action, the historical action of the drama. Mm-hmm.
I'd like to follow up on that, if I may, with a very personal story that Chris did not know about me when he asked me to participate. I first went to the Soviet Union in November of 1972. And so you'd think a decade had passed, but the Moscow streets, that's exactly what it felt like to walk at night in Moscow in the winter as somebody from the West. That story that Dominic just shared about people coming together, I was in high school when I went, and when we were in Moscow, you clearly knew you were in a Cold War environment, right? Being followed, people going into your rooms, those kinds of things. But the further we got away from Moscow, the less that was true. And the group I was with spent 2 or 3 days in Novosibirsk in Siberia. And there are no hotels for international visitors in Novosibirsk. So we're in a hotel with Soviet citizens, we're in restaurants with Soviet citizens, perhaps carefully selected, I don't know. But we're at table with them, talking about our families and our schools. And then the music starts and someone says, do you want to dance? I'm a high school student. Sure, I want to dance. And I came home with exactly that conversation in my head that Oleg had with Andrew at the dinner table. You know, why do you hate us? Well, politicians may, but people don't. And when I had to go into my high school and then tell about my trip, that's the story I told, was I was raised on stories about the Soviets or the Russians or the communists. And here I am going, well, this is Vladimir and this is Tamara. And they were truly just people. And so that for me was a very personal moment in this film. And I was glad it got such prominence in 2 or 3 places, because that's the question Andrew would have asked. Mm-hmm. And I think it's the answer he would have left with. It was the answer I left with.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And Claire, as we were chatting, you mentioned how many details of the film came back to you, or the film brought many details of that trip back to you, and got so much of it right. You know, that's one of the things that we always say as we're sort of looking at history film, that you know documentaries do what they do, and reading a monograph or looking at primary source material does what it does. But one of the things that films can do is bring that allow for emotional learning by capturing a moment and so forth. And Claire, you mentioned that the key lady scene really took you back.
Trying to explain key ladies when we came home to people who had never experienced them. And what people may not realize is that would have been a hotel just for international visitors. And that's exactly what they looked like and what they did. And when I was there, we were not allowed to carry our passport, our hotel keys, or any of that. And so it truly was, I was having an immersive experience the moment that you walked him through all those hotel scenes. But the key lady, you absolutely nailed.
I went actually on a school trip in 1983 during the Andropov period. We went to Leningrad, as it was then, in Moscow, and it was so helpful. Just with that sort of the sort of detail you're describing, although of course 20 years later, but even 20 years later, there were many things that sort of stayed with me, and it had a profound effect on me. Mm-hmm. I mean, I can remember so much detail from that trip, and how it was, and exchanges as you've described, even as a 17-year-old, where you made a connection with someone. It was just a sort of human moment, and which, you know, is very powerful. You know, I mean, our trip was totally sort of policed in that we weren't really allowed to do anything. And then we just sort of got fed up with it and took a day off and we went around Moscow.
I cried at the Bolshoi. I mean, right. When I saw Swan Lake at the Bolshoi, I cried. Right.
Yeah. Well, I wasn't. Actually, you hadn't been, had you, Tom? And yet it did have... it did have a lot of that feel in the original script. And the other thing I think is sort of amazing is that Tom really captured the British. Which as an American, isn't that necessarily that easy to do? I mean, you hadn't been to Britain, you didn't, but you absolutely got that sort of very formal behavior that is still around in Britain now in the establishment, but was absolutely the norm at that point, you know.
Yes, I felt that that really came out well by the characters, the CIA and MI6 characters that were closest to Wynne. One last question. You know, there are so many films about the Cold War, and we've told the story, you know, over and over again. What did you hope, and what do you hope people take away from this film that's different from the other tellings of these stories?
I think if I can jump
in. Off that, Tom. I've done a lot of talking.
Okay. You know, I think for this particular film, one thing that's important to me is, I think as Dominic mentioned at the beginning, is that, you know, MI6 never made any public acknowledgement at all of what Greville Wynne had done, of the sacrifice he'd done, of what he had accomplished. They disavowed, they didn't want to acknowledge he'd actually done work for them. And so part of Wynne's legacy was that no one knew the heroism that he had performed. And I think one thing that's nice about this movie is is that Wynne will get his place in history where he, as he deserves to have. And I think for me, that's something it's that one person's story that hasn't been told yet that touched so much rest of what happened during the Cold War. That to me is there's something really nice, sort of closing a circle there with Wynne's, the knowledge of Wynne in the world.
I agree with that. And in fact, I had a funny exchange with someone who I know works at MI6. I don't know if I'm supposed to know that. I obviously won't reveal their identity. And they said to me, they have an administrative problem. They said to me, why are you making a film about that awful man? And I think, you know, what he actually did was sort of forgotten because they wanted him to go away and shut up. And I, you know, they were annoyed that he didn't. And they, as far as they're concerned, he got arrested. So he didn't, you know, he didn't really succeed. And I think that they were very instrumental. My sense of it is they were quite instrumental in this sort of the story not being one more widely. And so why individuals like this played, you know, it's a unique contribution.
Well, I want to thank you both. Thank you all for joining with us today in discussion of the film. I want to congratulate you again. And thank you for making such a wonderful film that adds to our understanding of this moment and of history. And I hope folks go out and enjoy the film and do what I did, which was head to Google and start learning more and more and diving into this history that it inspires us to look at. So thank you again for joining us today.